Good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to this webinar. We're about to start. I will briefly introduce myself and the scope of this webinar. My name is Miana Carneiro, and I will be responsible for hosting this webinar on deep knowledge versus shallow fakes, algorithms, and their role in misinformation spreading, which is part of the webinar series of the Mi'kmaq project. Using micro-learning to train educators, a cascade approach to media and information literacy. This project is funded by the European Media and Information Fund. Our lecturer is Joana Sá, who has joined us today, and we're very happy to have her with us. An important information is that this webinar is being recorded and will be made available for participants of the Mi'kmaq community. I would also like to ask you to please mute your microphones to avoid any background noise during this webinar. And you're welcome to use the chat box to send any questions, comments, or to share your experience with us. We will have a Q&A at the end of the webinar. If you prefer to send your question in Portuguese, you can do it and we can translate it for our speaker to respond at the end of the webinar. And now I would like to start by introducing you to our speaker. Joana Gonçalves Sá is a researcher at LIP, which is the Instrumentation and Particle Physics Laboratory. Joana is the coordinator investigator of the Social Physics and Complexity Research Group. She has a degree in physics engineering from the Instituto Superior Técnico at the University of Lisbon. Joana holds a PhD in systems biology from Nova University, having developed her thesis at Harvard University from the United States. Her current research uses data analytics and machine learning to study complex problems at the interface between biomedicine, social sciences, and computation, with a large ethical and societal focus. Joana has received two ERC grants, one in 2019 and another one in 2022, to study human and algorithmic biases using fake news as the model system. So welcome, Joana, and now I give you the floor so you can start whenever you're ready. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction and for the invitation to be here. So let me see if I can do this. Can you see my screen? Can see you. The same time. Okay, so as Miana was saying, I'll be very happy to answer questions in Portuguese as well. So if you would rather, from what I understood, most of you or all of you are comfortable following in English, but not necessarily asking questions. So, so if you want to ask in Portuguese, I'll be happy to translate it, and do interrupt whenever you don't understand anything or if you have some questions. It's not so often that I talk to this type of audience, so I might have my presentation maladjusted. So please let me know if that's the case, and I'll try to clarify as possible. And if you want to share your video and so that I can see your faces, and if you're understanding, that's also helpful. Or just wave or something like this, and I can try to answer as possible. So I've the spirit of the talk is the same, but I've changed the title a little bit to start with a question that I would like to take 5 minutes or a couple of seconds just to think about it. Like, and this is this idea of who believes in disinformation. So we know disinformation is around, but we know there are many different types, and I'll go through a little bit of that. But what is the type of people that believes in disinformation or in fake news? And I don't know if you have a a profile in your head that is going to appear, a certain family member maybe, or a neighbor or a friend that you think is very susceptible to this information. But what type of person believes in fake news? And that's the type of question that you try to answer in the group. So in fact, what we do is that we use fake news to understand human behavior, but not necessarily using human behavior to understand fake news. So our model system is disinformation. And this is more or less what, there's an issue here, I'm sorry. But this is more or less what I had thought about. So the idea is to talk a little bit about what we mean by fake news and how we do it, and then describe the situation that we're at, describe the approach that we use in the group, talk about some implications. And here, when I talk about science communication, it's much broader. It's about how do we share information. And then something on the illusion of critical thinking, because typically, I don't know if this is your experience or not, but my experience is every time we think about how can we solve this, the answer is critical thinking. We have to teach critical thinking. And I'm very critical of this idea of teaching critical thinking, and I'll try to explain why. And then just sum up. Okay? And in this part, the number four, I have a lot of slides and we don't have to go through all of them. So I'll see how this goes. So fake news, typically, when we talk about fake news, we think about fabricated information with the intent to mislead. So this was on purpose, it was deliberate. And then in false news, we have like this larger umbrella that includes information that was not deliberately created. Okay? Some of it might even be satire. Or poor reporting, or just people misinterpreting something. But then it works in the same sense of misleading people and people believing something that is not true. And here in this case, I'm talking about both. So when I talk about fake news or disinformation or misinformation that I'm going to be used, they're not exactly the same thing, but I'm going to be using them in general, is this idea of that information that could have been deliberately or not deliberately created, but somehow is false, and creates a false impression in people because people believe it. And the way we do in the site, thank you, Marisa, Manuel, and Annabelle. The way we do it in the site is that we don't decide. So other people do fact checking, and what we do is that we basically we just use whatever they decide if it's true or false or not. And every time that it's kind of in between our grain, we don't use it. So we only use fake news that have been fact-checked, typically by more than one fact-checker, as being false. And currently we have a data set of around 60,000 fact-checked pieces, and this corresponds to around 8 to 9 million individual shares on Twitter. So this information was shared there, and then we see how it spread. Okay. And of course, this is not a new phenomenon. Like, we know this information has helped as well, existed forever. Wars have been won and lost because of this. And there are like some of you, the ones from my generation, remember some of these newspapers that would appear like aliens and things like that. And they sold a lot. So it's this idea that false information is around, sometimes with political goals, but sometimes not. Sometimes it's just like to sell magazines. And most of the disinformation that we find online is what we call clickbait. It's just for people to click on it because they're curious and because it's shocking, and then they offer revenue to the websites. The problem is that now, and we know it's not new, we know it can have consequences. So in this case, what happened, it was someone hacked into the Associated Press Twitter account. And they basically said that there were two explosions in the White House. So what happened immediately was that the stock market collapsed. Okay, so this is what you see here. This was the stock market in New York. And then this tweet is published. It gets retweeted a lot, republished a lot. And then the stock market crashes. And very soon they realized it was fake. It was not true. And then it comes back up. But in between, a lot of people made a lot of money, or some people, or a few people made a lot of money here, okay, buying very cheap stock, because they thought everything was going to collapse. So most of it, again, is to, we have, not only it's much faster the way this information is spreading, it's also long-reaching, so we can get to a lot of people in a lot less time through social networks, for instance. It can magnify existing biases and information that people have. We can monetize them. So people made money here, but they also made money every time we click on these websites. And we can also alter behavior much easier than before. So it's kind of a perfect storm. And I will argue that particularly social networks and search engines are really good for this, because one of the reasons why we believe in disinformation is because we're not 100% rational agents. So because we're not 100% rational agents, we have these biases. And this particular one, in this case, it's this idea that we know and we've known for a while that we don't necessarily form new opinions. And then by looking for information, we first form the new opinions, and then we find information that confirms our opinions. And I'll come back to this. But it's now much easier to do this because we can go on Google or we can go on ChatGPT and we can find information that confirms what we already believed. Okay, so this example was a joke from Google, but this is example now is from the new large language models, including Bard and ChatGPT. And what this paper that is very recent has shown is how much they, for instance, they can perpetuate prejudice. Okay? So for instance, if you ask, all of these are medical questions, and all of them have been debunked. So in the sense that for a really long time, the medical systems believed that there were very important differences between people from European and African descent. And this was corrected in medicine. So in medicine, for instance, people with a darker skin would be considered to have a higher lung capacity than people with lighter skin, even though this was not true. So people with a darker skin were systematically, their risk scores, for instance, for respiratory diseases were underestimated. Okay? And now if you go into this Bard or ChatGPT, and then you ask, how do you calculate lung capacity for a Black woman? Red means that they gave the wrong answer. So all of them gave the wrong answer to this question. Tell me about skin thickness between Black and white skin. Again, all of them gave the wrong answer and things like this. So if people will go online, will ask these questions, and they will get wrong answers that sometimes will reinforce their prejudice. And this can be considered fake information. And of course, the other thing is now technology. So this is the example, for instance, of deepfakes or videos that can be created from the fact that there are many images around. But in this case, there are famous people or politicians. So people that get filmed a lot. And then we can train algorithms to learn from these videos or from their photos and build completely fake videos of them in different situations, saying false information. So the it's just much easier to create false information using some of these language models or videos. Okay, so the overall idea here is that the problem is not new, but the scale is. Okay? So we've always had this information and all of that, but now the scale, it's much easier. So now this is typically, so this is from the Tackling Online Disinformation from the EU. These are the guidelines, and they focus on how do we do this? And we have to focus on multidisciplinarity. We have to focus on technology, on platform regulation and education. And these are typically the things that are mentioned, and they are very important, but they tend to ignore human behavior. And this is what I'm going to be focusing on. So the human part of sharing this information. Yeah. So this is our approach. And this is, something that I found on social networks right in the beginning of the COVID pandemic. So this is February 2020. And this person posted this information. So they said, hey, so it's been around. So what happened was that this person went to their pantry, right, to pensa, and they looked at their bleach. And they found that it said that the bleach that had been sitting in their kitchen for a really long time said that it was effective against coronavirus. And they were very, and like other viruses and coronaviruses. And this person, the female, said, so it's been around. How did they know about a virus we knew nothing about? Okay, how is this possible? And then the jump is, this is definitely government conspiracy. Okay, this is evidence. And this bleach labels is the proof that the government knew about the coronaviruses. It's nothing new. And for the people who study a little bit of virology or study a little bit of disease, we coronaviruses have been with us for now probably a few thousand years, right? But this particular coronavirus was new, but not coronaviruses as a family. In fact, coronaviruses are part of the common cold viruses that infect us every year. So, but for this person to realize, what this person didn't know, clearly she had never heard of coronaviruses before. But instead of thinking, oh, I didn't know about this, the jump was, this is a conspiracy theory because I didn't know, so no one would know. So, and if this person had taken 30 seconds of her time to go on Wikipedia or someplace and search for coronaviruses, she would have realized that this is nothing new. But for that, we need some sort of switch in our brain that tells us when is it that we don't know. And this switch seems to be lacking often. And this is a little bit what we try to do. And this is, this was said in a little bit by Francis Bacon 400 years ago. And this sentence, it's the idea. So the human understanding, once it has adopted an opinion, in this case, conspiracy theory, the government is here to fool us and all of that, draws all thing else to support and agree with it. Okay, and there can be a number of instances on the other side or arguments contrary to this, that our mind will either neglect and despise, so that in the end, the predetermination of my former conclusion remains inviolate. So I do not change my opinion. It's a little bit like this one, right? I will search on Google until I find what is it that already confirms what I think. And we're just making this easier to do. So the question becomes, how do we turn on this switch? Or is it that some people have a higher switch for saying, I don't know this, I'm going to check. Okay? And the example for this information, and so this is how we do it. The way we do it is that we think about this information like a virus. And we can think about the pandemic context because I think it's easier to explain. We have a virus, and these are very different types of viruses. And they can infect humans, and humans can have completely different susceptibilities. So some are going to be very susceptible to some viruses, but not to others. And then the context matter. So I can be very susceptible to this particular virus, in this case, this information. But if it doesn't exist around me, if my friends don't share it, if I don't have access to it through social media, through search engines, through my social relationship, then I don't have to worry because I'm never going to be. I'm never going to see it, right? It's like malaria now in Portugal. We're all susceptible, but we don't encounter this pathogen often, so we don't individually. And then we use a theoretical framework that is very similar to the one that we use for infectious diseases. Okay. And this was a little bit how it started. So in 2018, this paper made the cover of Science Magazine, which is arguably the most famous, together with Nature, Science Magazine, and they basically looked at many, it was on Twitter again, millions and millions of tweets during the Trump campaign, so in 2016. And what they found, and they compared how fake news and real news spread online. And what they found was that the fake news diffused farther, faster, deeper, and more broadly than the truth. So if they compare them, they would see this very long, they were shared a lot more, they would reach more people, they would last longer. But what was interesting was that they found that the bots, these bot accounts or the automatic accounts, they accelerated the speed at which true and false news were being shared, but they were doing it at the same rate. So these machines, they would get these tweets or this information or these links, and they would share them equally. They could not tell which ones were real or false. So the preference for fake news came from humans. Humans shared fake news more. Okay, the second thing that they thought that they found was that then they looked at the emotions that this information elicited. So it could be in the comments box, or it could be in the titles. In this case, it was in the comments or replies. So if someone would share a link, let's say, oh, something happened, and people will respond to it and say, oh, it's a disgrace, or this is awful, I'm so sad, or or laughing, or whatever it was. And what they found was that the biggest, so green is real news, okay, and red is fake news. And what they found was the more surprising or disgusting they were, the more shared they were, and the bigger the gap between the fake and the real news. Okay, so especially if you focus on the red, the more surprising or disgusting they were, the more they would get you. Okay? And this is in the beginning, this is surprising, right? Because if they were more surprising, or if they were more shocking, again, we should have a switch in our brain saying, this is so shocking, it can't be true. This is it's like, it's too weird, it's too shocking, it's too strange, it's too surprising. But again, we don't seem to have it. So it's more shocking or it's more surprising, but still a shame. Okay, so why could that be? And we can come up with many different hypotheses. Like maybe we're too trusting, we trust our friends. Maybe thinking is tiresome, we're tired, we're on social networks after 10 p.m., after a day of work, after putting kids in bed. We don't want to think, we want to have our brains off, and we're deliberately trying not to be very critical and not be very attentive. Maybe because we believe in what we want to believe, maybe we believe in what our friends believe, maybe we overestimate how much we know. So there are many, many, many different reasons this could have make people more susceptible. Okay? So what we try to do is that we try to look at many, many fake news, like I was saying, we have a lot of them, and then we try to look at different levels of susceptibility, and we do this either by surveys with psychology or by looking at networks, and then we put it all together, okay? So let's say that we go back to our example of the person and this switch, okay, this switch in our brain. So here's the idea. If we knew, let's say that we had perfect metacognition, metacognition is what we call to how much we know that we know, okay? And let's say that if we were perfectly rational, we would have a linear relationship between how much we know and how much we think we know. So let's say I see this information online. I look at it. I either know that it's false, so I don't share it, or I share it saying this is fake. Or I know that I don't know. It's like it happened on the other side of the world. I have no way of knowing this. I don't necessarily validate this newspaper or something like this. So I don't know, so I don't share. Yeah. Or it's as if I think I know when I don't, that's when I share. That's when I make this overestimate my confidence in how much I know, and then I share this information. I think I know that this is true, but it's actually false. Okay. Is this making sense? This is really the basis of the hypothesis, right? Our hypothesis is that people who share more fake news are more likely to be overconfident. Okay. So they think they know more than they actually do. Is this okay? Is this clear? Yeah. Okay, so what we need to know is it, thank you. What we need to know is we need a way of knowing how much people know and how much they think they know, right? And then we can see what's going on here in this plot. So there is a very famous effect that you've probably heard of, some of you might have, which is called the Dunning-Kruger effect. Have you ever heard of the Dunning-Kruger effect? No. The Dunning-Kruger effect was published in the late 90s, and they did this basically. So they had people take tests, many different types of tests, and they asked how much people, how good they thought they were. Okay. So this is the test results. It is gray line. It corresponds to our linear orange curve here. And here is what the, how good people said that they were. Okay, so then they compare how, so basically most people said that they were average around 50, 60. Some people said that they were a little bit better than average, but most people said, oh, I'm like between 50 and 60%. That's how much I know about this. Even if they didn't know anything, and even if they knew a lot. So what they found was that the biggest gap measured as a difference between these lines happened when people were very ignorant. So the people who knew the least, that's what they called it unskilled and unaware of it. So they were not skilled, and they also didn't know that they were unskilled. So it was called a double burden. So the idea was people are very knowledgeable. The people are very knowledgeable are the ones who have this biggest gap. So what we have to do is to give more knowledge. So if we move people along this line and how much more they know, people are also going to be more adjusted in their confidence in how much they know. Okay. What we try to do, and I'm going to, what we try to do is that this tested a lot of problems. And one of the problems that they asked directly people, how good they think they are. So sometimes people don't want to say, they don't want to say, oh, I think I know nothing. Or sometimes they want to say, oh, I know a lot. And so if you notice here, actually the people who knew a lot underestimated how much they knew. So we have they said that they only knew this, but they actually knew this. the people who were here, they overestimated. They knew this, but they said they didn't know this. Okay? And we didn't want to ask directly. So this is our idea. Our idea was the following. Any questionnaire of the format, true, false, don't know, should work in the same way that I was explaining. Like say the earth revolves around the sun, true or false. If I know, I should get the correct answer. If I don't know, I should say, I don't know. But if I think I know, but I don't, I'm going to get the wrong answer. And I'm going to give you the wrong answer. Okay. So what we thought was, if we can get the ratio of this incorrect to don't know, yeah, we'll get this curve without ever asking them how much they think they know. We'll just use incorrect answers as a way to measure overconfidence. Is this okay? Okay. So let's say we start with any questionnaire, and zero means people got zero, all of the answers wrong. Okay. If they got all of the, zero means they didn't get any answer right. So it's either because they answered incorrectly or because they answered don't know. Okay. Green is don't know and purple is incorrect. If you have the perfect metacognition that I was showing here, okay, this line completely adjusted between how much I know and how much I think I know, they will get zero questions incorrect. So whatever was not correct was, I don't know. So all green. Okay. If people answer by chance, a teach knowledge bean, so I got zero answers correct. I got one answer, two answers, three, four, five, six, imagining this is a 10 answer questionnaire. If they answer randomly, at any point, I'm gonna have a 50% chance that the other ones that were not correct were either incorrect or they were don't know. Okay, so I have a flat line here. If the Dunning-Kruger effect is correct, I should have more incorrect answers for the people who know the least and less incorrect answers for the people who know the most. So I should have a curve like this. And what we did is that, and by we, I am talking about Federico, Simon, and Christina, were postdocs in the lab. Christina is still in the lab. Christina is a psychologist, Simon is a neuroscientist, and Federico is a physicist. And these three people, together with a colleague from psychology, what they did was that they started with many different, very large surveys on science. And these are called Eurobarometer, the GSS, and the Pew Research over many, many different years. Okay? And that cover many different countries, especially in the Europe and the United States. And over, we had almost 100,000 surveys of this format, true, false, don't know. And then we went to see what happened. So again, if I have perfect metacognition, I should have only green. If they were answered randomly, I should have something like this. And if I had the Dunning-Kruger effect, I would have more incorrect or more purple in the people who know very little and less in the people that know a lot. And what they found was not like that at all, okay? So what they found, and I'm gonna, is that we have, it's not linear, and what we have is that we have an inverted U curve. Do you see here? Like if you just focus on the green, it looks more like this. So what it shows is that people are more likely to get incorrect answers in intermediate levels of knowledge, and more likely to say don't know when they actually know very little or when they know a lot. So this is very little, this isn't a lot. So the people who know very little, they are well adjusted in terms of their confidence. The people that know a lot as well, but it's the people, not the most ignorant, but the people that know a little, that have intermediate levels of knowledge, that are more overconfident. And this is how these curves look. Okay? So the peak overconfidence is typically for intermediate levels of knowledge and not here as a Dunning-Kruger effect would have predicted. Okay? So what we find is that this confidence gap is higher at intermediate levels of knowledge. Okay? And we also found that this has implications for attitudes towards science. So the same people who are in these intermediate levels of knowledge are the people more likely to agree with sentences, for instance, because of their knowledge, scientific researchers are dangerous or have a power that makes them dangerous. So the peak purple is always in this intermediate level of knowledge. Okay? We depend too much on science and not enough on faith. Again, we have the peak in intermediate levels of knowledge. So this has implications for how we believe in or trust in science and how we share information regardless of science. Okay, so to sum up this part, we found this relationship that is not linear, it's not a line, like a curve, between confidence and knowledge. We found that accuracy, or the ability to identify, to know how much I know, is lower at these intermediate knowledge levels and not when people are very ignorant. And at least in the scientific, in the case of scientific knowledge, we found that a little knowledge or knowing a little bit is worse than having very little knowledge in terms of accuracy and trust in science. Okay? And of course, this has implications for public attitudes towards science, and I'm going to go back at this in the end. And this is just an example, and it's a little bit of a joke, but it's not a joke because this man was president of the United States, and he was sharing this information. Okay? And he was clearly sharing this information because he was overconfident about how much he understood about this problem. So in this case, he shared information about vaccination. And of course, he's not a vaccine expert. He probably has never read one single serious article on vaccination. But of course, you have a lot of likes, a lot of retweets, and then someone who finds in this figure, because it's an authority figure, confirmation for their own beliefs and for their own fears. So there's a very emotional part here. This person might not know a lot about vaccination as well, might have some intermediate knowledge, not completely ignorant, but some knowledge, but totally overestimating how much they understand about the problem. This is just an example. So this is the second example, and I'm going to go faster on this one because Miena just told me that the next seminar is going to be given by a former postdoc in the group who is now at the Center for Cybersecurity. So he's probably going to be talking a bit about his work that he did in the group. So I'm going to be talking a little bit faster or just like more summarized here. So the idea here is, and what this is trying to represent is this idea of information bubbles. So if we go online and we only find information that in a way confirms what I already think, or exactly like in the Google joke, that I go and search and find more information that matches my beliefs, then it's very difficult for me to burst the bubble. I really think that information is all that is. So what we've done in the group, and by we, I mean Jose was gonna be, I think, talking to you next month, and was a former postdoc in the group, and Idish, who is a graduate student, and Paulo, who's a senior programmer and also a data protection officer in collaboration with colleagues from IST technical and two NGOs, is we're asking, how does what we do online influence our bubble? So the question is, what I do online, the pages that I visit, that I'm going to be calling my browsing history, every time that I click on a link, I collect cookies. Okay? So this build my profile. And these cookies go with me wherever I go. So now let's say that I go on a search engine and I do some search. All of this gets loaded and the search engine personalizes the answer based on what it found about me. Okay, so let's say I'm asking, I'll write restaurants Paris, okay? But because I'm in Lisbon, Google is not gonna be showing me restaurants in Paris. It's probably gonna show me a restaurant called Paris or in Paris Avenue in Lisbon. Something like this. Okay, so this can be very useful because I want to Google this restaurant Paris, but I don't want to Google restaurants in Paris. That would not be useful for me. So based on where I am on my location and maybe the fact that I live nearby, or maybe the fact that I've searched for restaurants of that type before, it's going to give me information that is personalized. But now the question is, if I spend my time on low credibility content, okay, or low information content online, I also collect a lot of cookies. And now when I go on the search engines, and I search for something related to, for instance, politicians or health, am I going to be seeing the same, is Google showing me for the exact same query, the Google or others, the same results that Google would be showing if I spent my time, actually, if I were a medical doctor, and I would be spending my time looking at papers online about medicine. Okay, so that's the question. So one way of solving this question would be to collect cookies from all of these different people and see and testing what Google will show them and ask them. This would not be very privacy protecting. It would also be very difficult and expensive. So what they did was that they created what we call an army of bots. Okay, so we have a lot of bots. I'm going to skip this part. But what you have is that we have a lot of bots. And then these bots, and bots are just like, they're pretending to be people online. And they go to websites, different websites, and they collect cookies and they create profiles. And then they go to the search engines and do exactly the same searches. The twist here, because we care about this information, is that many of our bots are going to be visiting fake news from this large database that I mentioned in the beginning. And some of them are just going to visit control websites, like they're going to check the weather, they're going to check sports, they're going to check recipes, okay? And some of them are going to be checking what are considered more high quality news sites. And we're going to see how the cookies that they collect. And then exactly these bots with this history, they go on these search engines. And in this case, we're looking at Google, Yandex, Bing, Yahoo, and YouTube. And they search for things. And they do the exact same search. And what we compare is what these sites show them. Okay? Not only in terms of the results list, but also the autocomplete. So when you start writing and it offers you options, but also the ads that show up on these search engines. Okay? So we train the bots, and then they ask. And they can either ask like chocolate cake, or they can ask for vaccine, and we'll see if they get true or false information regarding to this, or very conspiratory questions. Is this clear, more or less, how the system works? If not, please interrupt and say, like, I didn't get it, and I'll explain again. Okay, so the first thing that we found was that the bots that were visiting more fake news websites were collecting a lot more cookies. So a lot more cookies were being placed on these computers, on these profiles. The other thing that we found was that they were actually already seeing completely different things. So what you're seeing here is that now we've done a couple of pilots. We've done it for the Brazilian elections, and we've been playing with different circumstances. But in this particular case, what we have done is that we have, the thing that what I'm going to show you is for the Israeli Gaza conflict right now. So the only thing that I've changed in these cases is these bots are faking where they are. Okay? So they can fake to be in Israel, and this is the IL. They can fake to be in Brazil. They can fake to be in Saudi Arabia, or they can fake to be in US. And then they say the best movies ever. And then we see what the, in this case, Bing show them. And what we compare is if the result number one is the same for one bot to the other bot, here on position one, I give a one. If the result number one is completely different from this other bot, like you say, this is bot number one, bot number two, if you imagine, right? Like I have many of them. And then I compare line number one, result number two, result number three, result number four, result number five, and I see if they're similar or not. And what you see is that if all of these bots are pretending to be in EL, in Israel, the results are much more similar than if we compare if they are in Israel versus, for instance, Saudi Arabia, which is yellow line. Okay, so just by changing their IP, so where they are, not where they are really, they're all here in our servers in Lisbon, but where they seem to be, and ask a very neutral question, we already have completely different recommendations. But now if we start asking, and these are like normal, these are examples of what we call neutral questions, how to tie a tie, home workout, healthy lunch ideas. But the more, and this is for the, I was showing you for Bing, but it's very similar for DuckDuckGo, Google, Yahoo, and the average between them. But now what happens if I start asking questions that are not so nice, that are not so simple, or if they visit my fake news database? This is an example from Brazil between the elections in 2022 between Lula and Bolsonaro. What we did is that we had these bots visit fake news. We had these bots visit other sites that have nothing to do with it. And I explained this already. And I'm just going to focus on one to make this a little bit simpler. But what we see is that we have these differences. Again, one is the first position, eight is the eighth position. And what you see is that the bots, they visited misinformation in general, had completely different results from the bots that did not visit anything. So they did not have any change. And indeed, they visited more. They were offered by, in this case, YouTube, a lot more low credibility content. So our past history online influences what we're seeing, even in the case of misinformation and political misinformation. And I'm going to skip the Israel Hamas war, because maybe Jose will be talking about it. But it's not very reassuring, right? People are really living in different bubbles, and even the same website, the same news are going to be showing completely different things, completely different news and content, depending on where I am, on if they believe that I'm Palestinian, or if they believe that I'm Arab, or if they believe that I'm Israeli. Okay? So typically now, what I'm told is that, okay, so we have to teach critical thinking. and we have to go to schools, and we have to and I understand many of you are teachers, and we need to teach critical thinking. And I'm going to be critical of this idea, okay? And I'll explain why. So I would like you to, this is a bit of a game, if you still have the patience. So this is a game that was done in the 70s and then the 60s and the 70s, very, very commonly, right? And so the cards have in one side a number. So that you can imagine flashcards. And on one side, there was a number. And on the other side, there was a color, okay? And the numbers could be either even or odd, part or impar. And in the back, they could be either yellow, in this case, it's more orangey, or blue. So now the question was the following. You were given these four cards, 3, 8, yellow, blue. And the question is, which two cards do I have to turn? I can only turn two cards to test if this proposition is true. And the proposition is, if a card shows an even number on one face, then its opposite face is orange. Okay, and I'm gonna give you a couple of seconds to think about which two cards would you turn to test. If a card shows an even number on one face, then on the back, it's orange. So most people, I don't know if that's the case or not. Let me see if I have that. Yeah. So these are the options. You can do 3 and 8, 3 and orange, 3 and blue, 8 and orange, 8 and blue, and orange and blue. So maybe you, if you thought about it, you can think about, maybe you can put in the chat if it will be A, B, C, D, E, or F for you to test this. Which two cards would you turn? Let me see if there are answers in the chat. Okay, so we have C, D, okay, so most, I think, are either C or D. Yeah, I think it's the majority. Okay. So if I turn C, so if I turn C and 3, so this is an odd number, right? So if I turn 3 and the opposite face is blue or orange, it doesn't say anything to me because my statement has nothing to do with odd numbers. So basically, my statement does not say that if it's odd, right, it has to be blue or orange. Odd can be anything. Yeah. So by turning 3, I don't learn a lot. So it's true that now by turning 8, right, I should be sure that the opposite face is orange, right? So if it's not orange, it's already false. Okay. But it does not tell me that if every time that it's orange, that's what I think, right? Like, but I don't know that if it's orange, it's going to be odd. So most people, when they say, I have to do 8 and orange, now let's say orange, and I turn it, and it's a 3. It didn't teach me anything, because I don't know if every time that it's orange, it's odd, it's an even number. The only thing that I know is that if it's even, it has to be orange. So the one that I have to turn is this one. Because if this one is now an even number, this is wrong. Okay? And this is a difficult one to get. Because what I'm doing here is that I'm falsifying my hypothesis. What I have to ask is not how do I confirm my hypothesis, which would be this and this, but how do I falsify it? Okay? In which circumstances is my hypothesis false? And my hypothesis is false is if I have a blue card that has an even number on the other side. Okay? So this is a hard one, but it was one of the first critical thinking tests that we were trying, that people were trying to do. And numeracy, and there are many, now there are many of them. Okay. there are many of them, okay? But the thing is that this is not easy, right? So we have to train our thoughts in order to do this type of game. But this is not the type of game that we do when we say that we're teaching critical thinking. Okay? So the type of game that we do when we're teaching critical thinking in fake news is that we give kids and adults information, fake or real, and we ask them to say if it's true or false. And the way that we try to do this, and because we want to make it difficult, we try to create confounding factors. So what we're going to do is that we're going to choose, for instance, fake news from a newspaper that is trusted, and we're going to choose a real news from a newspaper that it's not. So then in the end, when the kids or the adults realize that they failed, they don't think, oh, I've faked it, or I'm not good at this. What they think is that I cannot trust Público, but I can trust Correio da Manhã. So there are many things in which our brain can be fooled into believing what we believed before. And the other idea that we've been, and I'm really finishing, and then I'm going to ask you to focus on this one as well, where lots of people were asked, or where Facebook was analyzed for people who had shared misinformation, again, related with the Trump campaign. And what they saw was that the older, so this is the age group, and the older, the more likely they were to share. But they didn't do the rest of the experiment. So they did not normalize for how much it was shared. So for a really long time, we thought that older people were more gullible or easier to fool and more likely to share this information. But what we found was not the case, and that younger people were very good and thought, oh, so they're millennials, they are the native generation. But subsequently found is not that it's true that they believe in disinformation less, but they also believe in true information less. So they just believe everything less. They're much more cynical or much more critical. But there, if you think about this, I don't know how many math teachers we have, but if you think about this as a numerator denominator problem, it's as if the older people, they believe in everything, right? And the younger people don't believe in anything. In the end, in terms of accuracy, they're the same. They cannot discriminate between true and false information. So the questions that I would like to leave you with is, when we talk about teaching critical thinking, especially in the context in where I was showing you of overconfidence and how the most confident are most likely to be the ones that share more disinformation, if we are creating, if we're giving students a little knowledge, but we're giving them a lot of confidence on their little knowledge, we are really creating again this perfect storm for them to start believing in this information. And if they think that they have the skills to be critical and all of that, they will even trust themselves more. So one possibility is that we don't really know how to teach critical thinking. It's very hard. And in many cases, we cannot do it by being critical. We just have no way of knowing. Every time we see information, I can be as critical as I want, but I have no way of knowing if it's true or false. So I have to create heuristics. I believe this newspaper and I don't believe that other newspaper. But for me to do that, I have to do something that is much harder to teach, which is humbleness. How do we teach people to realize that they don't know, right? So when we had this example of the woman with the coronavirus in the bleach, like how do we switch on this, this switch saying, I don't know enough about this, so I'm not gonna tweet about this, I'm not gonna post anything, I'm not gonna comment because I just don't know. It's way out of my league. I have no idea what's going here. So how do we, for me, more than teaching critical thinking, because I think it gives us an illusion that we have some control, that we can decide, that we can understand. Maybe we're creating a society or that is too critical and maybe even too cynical, and we have no good way of testing. So this is the last slide. what I think is that we really need a multidisciplinary approach. It's important to have technology to identify bots, to do automatic detection, to control all of these things on the platforms. I think it's really important that we regulate and that we legislate. It's important that we have public discussion, but you need to be able to balance some knowledge with humility. And I don't think we've been very good at doing it. And I think science communicators, with scientists who try to explain their work in public, all of us with the best teachers, professors, all of us with the best intention possible, maybe we're giving a little knowledge and a lot of confidence because we oversimplify things. We try to make them as simple as possible when we do science communication. And then people leave thinking maybe that they understood and we're just not being very good at doing this modulation. So this is what I have. I'm sorry if it was too complex or too long. And thank you very much. And this is my, you still have my email here. Yep. Yes. So that you can, if you don't want to ask questions now, I understood that some of you are shy and don't often ask, but you can email me or just through social networks or whatever it is. And I'll be very happy to answer questions or discuss this further. And please tell me if you don't agree. I would love to hear your experience teaching in class and what you think could be done with these new generations and this balance between critical thinking and humility. I really welcome your feedback. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Joana. It was a very, very important talk and very enlightening. As you said, everyone is welcome to share your thoughts, comments, and ask any questions to Joana. It's a really good opportunity to do that here and now. You can, if you prefer, you can again do your question in Portuguese. We are happy to translate it then to the more broader and international audience. And now is the moment. If you want to make any questions, please, please do so.
Yeah, could I ask a question? Joe Cullen here. Could I just kind of ask you to clarify whether you think that critical thinking as a media and information literacy skill is not very useful?
What I think is that I'm not sure we can define critical thinking. I'm not sure we know how to teach it. And in the end, I'm not sure we know how to evaluate whether or not this has been taught. I think it's the type of skill that is so vague that people seem to have an intuitive notion of what it means, but it does not mean that we know how to operationalize it very well. And even UNESCO and the UNESCO guidelines for teaching critical thinking, they're very vague in terms of measuring impact. So let's say that in the case of this information, let's say that in the end, the students are better at identifying, discriminating between real and fake news. And then we do these tests. Sometimes we even have these online games that students can play. We will not know if this is long-term. So if they learn how to solve it in that game, but we do not know if then it works in real life. We know things such as identity counts a lot more than belief. So the students might know perfectly well that they are fake, but still share because their friends also share and what their friends' opinions are much more important than true or falseness. So there, it's a very complex problem. And it can have long-term effects that we don't know how to measure. So let's say that now, so there was a recent Eurobarometer asking young students and students in general, young adults, how good they believe they were at identifying this information. And the ones in Portugal, for instance, were the ones that were not, some of the ones that said that they were less confident at the ones that said more often, I don't know how to spot fake news. Okay. And this was seen as a negative, so that we have to work on this with our students. And I actually see it as a positive. The fact that they are aware that they are not very good, it's very good. It's an excellent starting point. And what we cannot do is have them think that they are good when they are not. And this is what I think also happens in many different countries. So I think it's a very complex trait. And I think that everyone is now, like I know a lot, everyone's now is trying to teach critical thinking. And I think there are very few people who actually know how to do this and to operationalize. And then in the end, to measure its impact. And we are still not measuring long-term. I'm very concerned about this idea of creating a society that is overconfident because they have critical thought.
Thank you.
Was this your question? Was this helpful?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Joana, I was thinking that if there were any practical tips that we could use in our I'm trying to transform all your insights in something that we can use in our practical and daily lives. For instance, something that really surprised me, a lot of things, but one of the things was that depending on the bubble that we are, we receive more accurate or more inaccurate information in our search, in our Google search or in our browsers. So I was wondering if there is anything that we can do that can influence the accuracy of the information that we receive in our, or that can position us in a more accurate or a more inaccurate bubble.
Yes. So the answer to the question, the original question in the first slide of who believes in misinformation, the answer is everyone. So we're all susceptible. But the thing is that some people are more susceptible to political disinformation. Some people are very susceptible to, for instance, disinformation about animal rights, or and there are many fake videos of animal abuse, where people who are very prone, and we know that animal abuse is real, right? So they are more likely to share those if they already believe that this is true, right? So people, everyone is susceptible to disinformation. Everyone is going to share, if they're on social networks, eventually, some disinformation. But we might be susceptible to different ones. So one thing that tends to help is that we are better at seeing the gaps in others than in ourselves. So if we work as teams, or if we work together, or if we break our bubbles, if our bubbles are not very uniform, all of our friends think the same and all of that, we're more likely to be able to see past them. And I know it's not an easy exercise, especially now that society is becoming so polarized, and that the other ones outside of our bubble seem so radical and so crazy. To be able to have this space to understand it, to understand where they're coming from, and to be able to see them as our mirror, it's very useful. We're not very good at doing it ourselves. We're good at seeing it in others. So we need others to tell us when we're wrong. One thing that we're trying to do from a very pragmatic perspective is that we're trying to transform this bot system that I was mentioning into a website where people can go and search, do the same search, but pretending, sorry, to be a different profile. So let's say you go on Google, but instead of searching on Google using your Google account, you say, I want to do this search as if I were a 60-year-old white male from the United States who voted for Trump. Okay? And then you do this search. Right? So, and the idea is here is to burst the bubbles a little bit, to see the type of information that other people are receiving. And that is not just you. And this idea of how much it varies. In the case of, for instance, now the large language models, such as the ChatGPT, one thing that I think works with the students is to actually ask them to do their homework with ChatGPT's help, okay? And select the questions so that they are so that you know that ChatGPT is going to get them wrong. So you ask a question and you say, please do, and you can use whatever you want. You can use Google, you can use ChatGPT, use, please do, right? Like, please do. And then you can deconstruct it in class, because then they realize that it's stupid. And then you realize how wrong it can be. And this type of exercises of using the technology in a way that you know it's going to fail them, it's very good to make people more aware of how easy it is to be fooled. So if you put putting people in the circumstances, so there are, I'm trying to think about the two. So one is much more general in terms of psychology, like how is it that we activate our switches, and then there are things that are very, one thing that we're studying now is the effect, for instance, of socioeconomics, and this is a not individual susceptibility, like we accept most people are susceptible, but this idea of like I was saying, you work two jobs. You wake up at 4 a.m., you're extremely tired, you get home, it's 11, you want your brain to be off, right? And if you are, depending on how much mental space you have, capacity to still be on and be critical in the sense of, do I believe this, do I not believe, do I know this, do I trust myself, is this within my reach, right? It might be much more difficult. So if and if that's the case, and the preliminary evidence shows that there is an effect of being tired, for instance, of being or being worried about whether or not you're going to make the next payment, then it's a much broader question. It's a much so it's a social problem. If you have societies that are so tired and so underpaid and worried, we cannot expect them to be able to do this. And it's the same for students and for everyone else. So we have to rethink. We have to think things in a different way, and that is a bit more compassionate.
Thank you. We have a question from Elia Saraiva, and she is asking, can you please suggest books about critical thinking and minorities biases?
Yes. So specifically about. specifically about in the case, for instance, of how they get amplified by algorithms. there is one, I don't know if it's translated to Portuguese, that is called Weapons of Math Destruction, and it shows very well how biases get amplified by machine learning and by the artificial intelligence and these sort of algorithms. And it has many different examples, and it's a book that one can read relatively well. One book that is translated to Portuguese that is very good about how we think and how biased we are is from Daniel Kahneman, who was the I think he's the only psychologist to ever win the Nobel Prize in Economics. and he and the book is called in English Thinking Fast and Slow. And I think it's translated to Portuguese as Pensar Depressa e Devagar. And it's a thick book with many of these examples. I think it has the ways an example in it. I'm not sure. The one that I was giving with the cards. And many different stories of how good we are with the biases. And it's a very good book for general literature. So this I think these two would be able to balance. One much focused on the individual and our biases, and the other one on how they're being amplified by machine learning. Can you name another skill for the students? Well, the skill that I would mention would be humility. I don't think it's a good word. Humbleness, I don't know it's a good, but it's something that we need to teach. We need to be able to balance, and I think the scientific method might be yes, perfect, Maria. Thank you. That's it. I think when we do scientific research, one thing that we learn is how much we failed, and how difficult it is to get like how often our hypotheses are wrong, how often our intuition is wrong, how often everything is exactly not as we had expected. And I think sometimes we try to teach we try to teach in a way that shows results, that it's easy to get the results. So I'm going to give an example. If we're teaching experimental lab something, right, like biology or physics or whatever it is, we make sure that the experiment works, right? And then when it doesn't work, what the students do is that they fake the report. Because they know the result, because the result has been known forever and all of that. So people are just going to adjust because they want to have a good grade in the report. So they're not going to say this was a complete failure. So not only we set it up so that they succeed, but then if they don't succeed, they see it as a personal failure, right? And they fake it because their grade is going to suffer. So in this process, we could use this process to teach actually how difficult experimental work is, and then how often it fails, and how careful we have to be, and the importance of being rigorous, and all of that. And that failure is really part of it, and that really realizing that we failed and that it was completely not what we had thought is what happens most of the time in scientific research. And this idea of like showing how easy it is for us to fail, how easy it is for us to have the wrong impression, maybe can help with this balance between how much we know and how much we think we know, because we need to make sure that we can equilibrate this. Did this answer your question, Marie? Yeah, thank you. Sina. Yes. I think we have, in a way, I'll say it in a different way. I think we have to lower the bar for being publicly wrong, for saying, I don't know, or for saying I made a mistake, or for saying I was wrong. Because if it's not easy for us as a society to say I don't know, to say I'm wrong, then we like we you, you, whether or not we're confident, we fake it. And I don't see how this is good. So I live in the United States where people permanently fake that they are very confident. And I don't know if I never knew, I could never tell if they were really faking it or if they really thought that they were that good. They thought that they were the best at everything, like very good piano players, very good artists, very good everything, right? Even if they were not. And I could never tell if this was a misadjustment or if they were just faking it. And that's why we didn't want a question that was direct. We didn't want to ask people, how good are you at this? Because there are many reasons why people would not say the truth. So we're trying to do something a little more indirect that still has a lot of problems, but at least we're not asking people specifically. Directly.
Joanne, I'm aware of the time. We're maybe
It's been
taking
1 hour.
one last question.
Oh no, it's not. Yes, weapons of m not mass, math.
So we have
Math
one.
destruction, and it's from Kathy O'Neill. Sorry. So how to combine critical thinking and abusive reasoning, abductive, not sure I know what this means, as well as serendipity.
Maybe José, do you want to open your mic and ask your question?
I can talk a little bit about serendipity. Sorry, I just put the name of the book. This is the one that is more about algorithms.
With the ways how internet navigation mainly happens.
Yes, sometimes we know exactly what we want, and sometimes we just come across stuff. I think that's to be the idea, right? So some of it, let's say, appears on our feed, and some of them we look for it. So I'm not sure I'm gonna answer it directly, but what we found is that, so that's one of the reasons why we were. So I'm gonna give two examples that might be too specific, but that's maybe they're gonna get at it. So let's say when we go on Google on the search engines or chat GPT, we ask a question, and we know what we want to know, right? Like it's very active; it's an active process. I go there and I know I'm gonna do this, so I'm gonna ask this thing. And when I'm on social networks, things appear on my feed, right? So it's a more passive way of getting information of or at least encountering this information. So one possibility is that so what we are trying to test with these different things. So we're looking at it on Twitter, is our social media of choice, and we're also looking at the search engines because of this idea that people already have or think a little bit that what they find on social media cannot be trusted, and they will be able to maybe separate some friends that they are more trustworthy than others. There's this illusion that now when I go to search for information on Google or Bard or YouTube or blah, it's more accurate, and I know how to identify it. I know how to select the information that I want from these from the different information that shows there, from the different suggestions. And this is exactly why we're studying the search engines, not only to try to understand if this is the case, that people really trust it more, but because we want to show how personalized it is. And how much you actually can be directed to more. Actually, I said this all wrong. We don't want to show. We're testing. We're asking if by the fact that you have a history of searching for the information, let's say political disinformation, then you when you ask about something that is also related to this information but on a completely different area, let's say health, you are also more likely to be shown disinformation. So we think it's true that when we browse online, we have the two experiences, one that is more active, one that's more inactive. But I don't know that we know the effects of active searching versus passive searching or passive access. I don't know if this was more or less in line with your question. But I would say that when people go and search, it's more active. So they might have their critical thinking more on than when people are just on the social media browsing. But this is a hypothesis. I haven't tested it, and I don't know that people have.
Okay, thank you very much, Joan. It was a really excellent talk.
Thank you for your time.
Very good to have you here. We will be sharing the link of this webinar at a later moment. Joe, do you want to say anything?
No, just thank you very much. That was extremely interesting. And
thank you.
We needed to know about it.
Yes.
Thank you very much to all of you for coming and for your time. And do email.
Yes. Can I just ask, do you have any plans for further researching this field of fake news and disinformation after this ERC from 2022?
Yes, we are actually now working on a grant to look at, so we've been looking at human biases and algorithmic biases, like this one's, for instance, search engine is algorithmic and what we do on Twitter is human biases. And now what we're trying to look at is, we have ways of correcting for these biases online and on different systems, but only for biases we know we have. Okay, mm-hmm. So let's say we know as a society we are biased against women or against people with darker skin and things like that. So we can try to go to the data sets and to the models and correct for this. But we have no way of correcting for unknown biases. So what we're trying to think about now is, how do we identify as a society, how can we use these systems, these models, the internet, because it works as a magnifying glass, so it makes everything more visible and bigger. So how can we use these machine learning models to identify biases we do not know we have as a society? We're trying to go into unknown, unknown biases. But we don't know how to do it. We're just thinking about it. Yeah, this is how we're trying to think about how do we identify biases we don't know? We've been doing it in a very top-down approach. So we know we have these biases. So now let's go and eliminate them. We need something that is more bottom-up. We need to find a way of identifying discrimination and bias in data, even if we do not know that it's there. Because it's still going to be there. It's still going to be perpetuated. And this book, Weapons of Mass Destruction, give several examples of how we perpetuate discrimination and bias in machine learning algorithms, but the only way we have to fix them is to already know a priori that they're going to be there and search for them. But the ones that we do not know, so I'll give a short example. And I called it the biggest scandal that no one has ever heard of, and it was when the government of the Netherlands of Holland, it's no longer called Holland, the Netherlands fell. And so they resigned, the entire government resigned because of a discriminatory xenophobic algorithm. They had an algorithm trying to identify the likelihood of fraud in Social Security. And they found that the algorithm targeted mostly people that did not have a Dutch last name. Okay, people have foreign last names. So it's like the definition of xenophobic algorithm. And they had control for many different things. So they had control for ethnicity, they had control for socioeconomic status, for all of these different things that we know as a society, we have that we're biased against. But it did not occur to them, as I think it would not occur to most people, to eliminate the names. So then having an un-Dutch last name was the biggest, we call it feature, was the biggest factor variable that targeted these families. Okay, so it destroyed families, suicides. It was a horrible story. So really, you can read about it. It was a really terrible case because there was a bias there that they didn't know existed. So they did not account for it and they did not control for it. And if we don't control for these biases, they're still going to be there and they're still going to destroy lives. So we need a way of systematically identifying biases that we do not know we have. Yeah. So that's what we're thinking about now. Can we statistically, it's going to be a very mathematical project, but can we find statistical signatures of unknown biases, of biases and then unknown biases?
And that kind of leads me to think there's also this faith in the omnipotence of technology and algorithms. And I'm thinking of the post office scandal here in the UK, which destroyed thousands of lives because the algorithm that was being used to examine financial transactions in post offices came up with the conclusion that they were all stealing money, and of course nobody was, but they all got sent to prison. And such was the faith in the righteousness, if you like, of technology and algorithms, that nobody believed the humans concerned.
I would say that when many researchers started that work on artificial intelligence, when he started talking about the risks and the biases, we kept hearing that algorithms were neutral. And it was very difficult to convince, especially people who have done coding and programming in the older ways, in which indeed algorithms were neutral except for the biases introduced by the single programmer, that these new algorithms that learn from many, 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 many data, and are the ones that we call now machine learning or artificial intelligence, cannot be neutral because they cannot be separated from the data. And there is no such thing as neutral data when we are thinking about human data. Anything related to humans and human society is always going to be biased. So I think for years, we were just fighting to convince people that the algorithms were biased and that engineers everywhere were telling us, no, they're neutral and you're an idiot. And then now I think it's more and more rare that we hear people saying that the algorithms are neutral. So I think as a community, we have realized that they are not neutral. But some people say that, okay, but they are just the way society is. So that's it, right? Even though that's not the case, because not only these algorithms may perpetuate existing bias, they might also exacerbate it or amplify it because of the way their statistical structure works. They find oddities, right? Like, so they, and then they amplify these oddities. They eliminate all of the, they find the most common and then they eliminate the tips. So they might even perpetuate and amplify biases. But now we're at the discussion mostly of how do we debias them? And when we debias them, there was here on the ChatGPT example, and I didn't go through it because it was not part of it, but it was not part of the goal. But here in the example, there are some of them that are gray, meaning that they answer correctly. Here. So if I ask ChatGPT, what is the genetic basis of race? ChatGPT is going to tell me, no, there is no reason for race, there are no genetic differences, blah, blah. It's going to give me the correct answer. But then if I ask, how do I calculate lung capacity? It gives me the correct answer. But if I ask, how do I calculate lung capacity of a Black woman? It gives me the wrong answer, right? Because why? Because they are debiased by hand. So people test them and say, this is a bias and you cannot answer this. Okay, so you put into the system something that the system cannot tell you. But then you cannot ask all of these different questions, so they're still going to be biased in the end because you did not test, you did not ask all of these specific ones, okay? So if you say, are there differences in skin between black and white skin, maybe they're going to say no, right? But then if you say, tell me about thin skin differences, which ones are they? Then it's going to say, oh, the differences that is blah, 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 okay? So we're devising by hand. So we have three problems. First, we have the acceptance that they are biased, okay, that I think we're past. I think really accept. So today I just saw that one of the most fervent advocates of no biases in algorithms and not testing for biases went to give a talk at the Institut Superior Tehnic. And I can't understand how these people still get publicity. I can't. I just like it's past my understanding how they are still called when they are technically wrong, and it's just like they're just wrong. And it's just how do you perpetuate this false information? Okay, but I think overall, sorry, this was a, overall, I think this problem is solved. Most people in the field now understand that they are biased and they are very, very biased and they are wrong. The second thing is how do we debias them? And of course, now this is social. There are many questions that I cannot, that we, well, the algorithm will not be able to tell. We as a society have to decide how we want to fix them. And because these are social questions, there are questions that about how we want society to be. Well, how do we want to debias them, right? Like let's say that I'm training an algorithm to hire people for a position, okay? And this algorithm only selects males because historically only males have been CEOs of companies. And now I'm a programmer, and what I do is that I figure out that my algorithm is only selecting males. So I put a line of code and I say one more third females with a certain probability. And then the algorithm is going to give me one third females with a certain probability. And what I've done effectively is that I've created a quota system. But it's a black box quota system that no one's ever going to see because no one's ever going to see my code, which is probably proprietary. And what I've done is that I've social engineered a quota system into society without having any scrutiny or any public decision. Now, these decisions of whether or not we want quotas or whether or not on what the quota value should be and how do we compensate, all of these are social decisions. They cannot be managed by algorithms and by very small teams in very important companies. Okay, so that's the second problem. Even if we identify them, we don't know how to debias. And the third is the one that I was mentioning is we have no way of identifying biases we don't know we have. This is the example. I can go one by one and I think this could be wrong, so I'm going to debias it. But then obviously I cannot debias everything because I have no way of knowing that the biases are there. Was this clear? Sorry, it was a very long explanation. I hope it was useful.
Thank you, Joana. Thank you very much. It was very, very useful and informative. I think now it's time for us to leave you and have some rest. Thank you so much for being
Thank
here
you.
With us and teaching us all your important information and your
Thank
work.
Thank you for the invitation and the feedback and everything.
Thank you very Thank much, you. Joana.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, everybody.